company obtained a secret order in court to gag all the press in the UK from reporting anything related to the content of that report and the fact that they had been gagged.
In the US, hackers discover that the Republican presidential candidate Sarah Palin is apparently bypassing US transparency laws by using a private email account to conduct government business. WikiLeaks publishes her messages. After just 2 years, the site's made public over 1 million secret documents, but WikiLeaks as an organization continues to be largely shrouded in secrecy. Only Julian Assange and Daniel Domscheit-Berry appear in public, the latter under the pseudonym Schmidt.
Okay, hello everybody. My name is Daniel Schmidt, this is Julian Assange. We're here to make a short presentation about the WikiLeaks project. According to The National, which is something that we are kind of proud, it's one of the last quotes we had. So The National has said that we have produced more scoops in our short existence than the Washington Post in the last 30 years.
Their publication activities soon lead to counterattacks. When WikiLeaks release lists of censored websites, internet service providers in a number of countries, including Thailand, China, and Iran, shut them down. The more sensitive the material they publish, the more often WikiLeaks become the object of lawsuits and threats. WikiLeaks now attracts the attention of the US intelligence, who, in a classified report, claim that the site is a threat to national security and suggest ways of shutting it down. Priority is put on finding the individuals leaking the information. The US intelligence, however, only managed to keep the report secret a short while before it's leaked to WikiLeaks. It now becomes obvious that WikiLeaks need to find more and safer havens from which they can publish their information. A sequence of events now starts on an island in the middle of the North Atlantic, which, while it leads to more censorship efforts, will also create new opportunities for WikiLeaks.
October came, October 2008, and the Icelandic banking system imploded. It lost 17/18 of its mass. Over the course of about a week or two, it was essentially one bank per week went bankrupt.
WikiLeaks obtained material that show how Iceland's catastrophic bank collapses were partly due to cronyism or favoritism, carelessness and secretiveness. When this highly detailed document is put out on the net, the bank launches a counterattack.
Well, the first time I heard of WikiLeaks was in the beginning of August 2009. I was working as a reporter for the state television when I got a tip that this website had an important document just posted online. The document was the high exposure loan book for the failed Kaupthing Bank.
It was essentially all of the regulators had been derelict in their duties. All of the bankers had been lying about the actual state of affairs.
The bank's management react in panic to the revelations and in a desperate move force the Icelandic judiciary to resort to extreme measures.
I was the first one actually to break that story. But the bank reacted in a manner that was quite interesting.
Gott kvöld, nú hefjast fréttir laugardaginn 1. ágúst. Samt ekki allar þær fréttir sem ætlum að segja ykkur.
They got a gag order on the state television, actually the first and only one in the history of the Icelandic state television news department.
Allir geta nálgast þau á vefsíðunni wikileaks.org.
The leak lays bare the disastrous effects of the cronyism inherent in Iceland.
We had failed as a country because we had not been sharing the information that we needed. we were in the middle of an information famine.
That sort of eventually led to this, just, let's get the WikiLeaks people here. And then when they were here, we just went, okay. Is there anything you want us to do? And obviously there was.
Welcome to this program.
Thank you.
You mentioned to me the dream that we in Iceland, we should become a vanguard of publishing freedom.
Yes. Absolutely, absolutely. So we see.
And they were presenting this idea, which they called Switzerland of Bytes, which was basically to take the tax haven model and transform it into the transparency haven model.
Why doesn't Iceland become the center for publishing in the world? Because it's going to be growing.
Julian and I, we were just throwing that idea out, just declaring on national television that we thought this would be the next business model for Iceland. So that felt pretty weird. Then realizing the next day that everyone wanted to talk about it.
Iceland has seen some of the problems that happen when society becomes too secret.
WikiLeaks gave us the nudge that we needed. We had had this idea, but we didn't know what to do with it. And they came and told us, and that is an incredibly valuable thing.
WikiLeaks now team up with Icelandic activists and parliamentarians and together draw up a proposal that would transform Iceland into a haven for journalism.
Herbert and I, and Birgit Jonsdottir, and Rob Kongreip, and Julian Assange, the five of us sat in this hotel room for about 4 or 5 hours and wrote the entire proposal from scratch.
The proposal is adopted unanimously by Iceland's parliament.
Just getting a bill accepted in the parliament is nearly impossible. And this is actually this is a huge victory for the parliament to have a proposal of this nature passed through the parliament with everybody saying yes.
It's also a victory for WikiLeaks, who are now not only using disclosures as a weapon, but also directly influencing freedom of expression laws. The entire hacker world behind WikiLeaks is growing increasingly confident that their visions will lead to an improved society.
Well, I think people that are dealing with systems, and technologically oriented people are dealing with systems, they understand systems pretty well. And if you look at society, that's just yet another system.
The people involved with WikiLeaks are exactly the same as me and the other people who are fighting this fight, in that they are information activists first and foremost. They believe in the power of information and power of knowledge and the importance of allowing everybody to have both of those.
Perhaps it's similar convictions that prompt a young former American hacker to make one of the most crucial decisions of his life. Bradley Manning, serving as an intelligence analyst with the US Army in Iraq early 2010, has, just like millions of other Americans in the military or civil service, access to a massive database of classified information. He discovers indications of crime and corruption and tells another hacker, Adrian Lamo, about it. Manning writes that he sent hundreds of thousands of military and diplomatic reports to WikiLeaks, the biggest leak ever. Manning puts his faith in WikiLeaks. However, Lamo reports their chat to the military. Manning now risks a 52-year jail sentence. Many of the facts are still unclear. One thing is certain. At this point in time, WikiLeaks receive documents with the same material that Manning is charged of having leaked.
We make a commitment to our sources that we will represent their material to the public to the best of our ability and achieve maximum political impact for the risks that they take.
WikiLeaks are in possession of explosive material, too big, in fact, for them to handle alone. Assange decides to stake all of his resources in one move.
We were sitting at a cafe in Reykjavik, and he basically just flipped over his laptop and told me, well, you gotta see something very interesting. I was quite shocked. This was something that I recognized instantly as a extremely important and strong material.
This is what the crew of an American attack helicopter see while out on patrol in Baghdad.
See all those people standing down there?
There's a group of men on the street below. Two of them work for the international news agency Reuters. The driver, Saeed Shma, and a cameraman, Namir Nur Eldin.
What annoys me the most is when people abuse their power and harm innocents, and they didn't actually need to do it.
Hotel 26 is Crazy Horse 18. Have individuals with weapons. 4-4 radio. Request permission to engage.
Roger that. We have no personnel east of our position.
For me, personally, somebody that had spent so much effort into trying to stop this war, that at least if this would be shown to people, that it might give people enough motivation to try to stop the next one.
All right, we'll be engaged. Roger, go ahead. I can't get them now because they're behind that building.
What shocked me with the video was the the high resolution, the quality of it, excessive use of force to shoot people with hollow 30mm bullets that are designed to penetrate armored vehicles and tanks, basically shot to pieces.
Let me know when you gather. We'll shoot. Light them all up. Come on, fire!
Hey, Roger.
Different people argue that it was right for the United States to be in Iraq, wrong to be in Iraq, but nonetheless, in this incident, even if you argue that it was right for the United States to be in Iraq, even if it was right for them to be in that suburb at that time with a helicopter overlooking this wounded man crawling the street, it was not helpful for the United States, for that wounded crawling man to be shot.
Yeah, we got one guy crawling around down there, but we got definitely got some. We're shooting some more.
The Reuters employee, Saeed Shma, has been seriously wounded.
He's getting up.
Maybe he has a weapon on his hand?
No, I haven't seen one yet.
It is very important to offer a voice to the voiceless. Nobody really believes the people on the ground when they're trying to tell what